not saying that his father is Saint John Vianney, the priest of Ars. He wasn't a great student, so they had a long time to be ordained, and they didn't really want to ordain him, but in the end, I think because he could say Our Father, Hail Mary, they allowed him to be ordained. And so, but he sent him to, the bishop sent him to some small village where he cannot do any harm. Anyway, nobody's going from us there anyway, so we'll just put him there and nice to be a priest for himself. But he was such a holy man, living such a holy life, that he started to just adore that sacrament, and he kept praying and praying and praying and praying for the conversion of souls until people one by one would come back to church. He spent about 16 to 17 hours hearing confession every day. So the priest would complain already this time because it's a penitential service twice a day. But he hid confession 16, 17 hours a day. How many hours left? And just to celebrate Mass and eat one potato and then sleep on a hard bed or on the floor because the devil had burned down his bed again. And so this was a great saint. And he came to witness in the whole priest. There was a simple farmer that would come to his church and sit in the church every day just to adore the Blessed Sacrament. And he was kind of intrigued by this simple farmer coming there to adore the Blessed Sacrament. And so one day he asked the farmer, "Well, every time I see you say the Blessed Sacrament, what do you pray and what do you say?" And the farmer said, "Well, that's very simple. I look at him and he looks at me." And that's actually the beauty of the Eucharist. That's the beauty of adoration. It's not so much about all that we can say, but that I get to see him and he gets to see me. And probably that second part is even more important. To allow him to see into me. Intimacy. Sometimes translated as into me see. Intimacy. Allowing God to see into me. Of course, God knows me true and true, but am I open to be seen? God still wants me to be open, even though he can already see, but for you to open up to him. Allow him to see who you really are. The Father is looking for worshipers that worship him in spirit and in truth. It's truth. And I don't need to wear a mask as I wear at school and at work. I can come really with all my sorrows and pains and joys and struggles, and I can just be myself and allow him to heal me and transform me. That is the Eucharist, that is adoration. To be in the presence of the Lord. And so he says we should consider moments spent before the Blessed Sacrament as the happiest moments of our life. Okay. So the last part of my talk I want to come to is four words that are key to this whole rekindle. Taken, blessed, propitiated. You talked about it already or not at all? Very good. Okay, now these four words, as I said, are taken in the Eucharist. You turn your page and you see Luke 24, and you can see these words, and I already highlighted them in verse 30. At table, he took the bread, taken. He said the blessing, so he took it, he blessed it, he broke it, and he handed it to them and shared it again. The four Eucharistic words, you can find the same four words as in the multiplication of the loaves, in any of the Gospels. You can find it also in all the other Eucharistic passages of mentioned Mark and Luke, where the Eucharist is celebrated. He took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he shared it. Now this applies to the Eucharist, it also applies to us. We too are taken, blessed, broken, and shared, and we are called to be a Eucharistic people. So, now, in the Eucharist, during the liturgy, we place bread and wine on the altar. Why do we place bread and wine on the altar? Why is somebody tasked to do the liturgy bringing bread and wine? Why bread and wine? The work of our hands, yes, very good. Essential for life, okay, but it could have been rice and fruit juice or water, maybe more essential for Asian life. So, why bread and wine? Where do we find this? Where do we find find bread and wine in the scriptures. We said it in the Passover in Exodus, where we have the Lamb of God, I talked about the Lamb of God. And so in memory of that, the Jews will celebrate, even until today, every day, year they will celebrate their Passover meal. The Passover meal, which is, the highlight is the lamb, but it also has bread, and it has four cups of wine, bread and wine. And the bread was unleavened because they were traveling, they were running, so they couldn't take leavened bread, so they had unleavened bread. So today we had this unleavened bread. Now at the Last Supper, when Jesus was supposed to celebrate this Passover meal, this Jewish Passover meal, he gave it its new meaning, its full meaning, the fulfillment of the Old Testament, in which there was no lamb because he was the lamb. And the bread and the wine now become the body and blood of Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Now, that's why we offer bread and wine. Of course, also because bread and wine is our daily sustenance, especially the bread. That's why in the Eucharist we say, our Father we say, give us this day our daily bread. Which isn't just bread, but the things that we live on, our daily sustenance. But in the Latin translation of the Greek word quotidianum, which is difficult to translate, you can say that it means daily, but another translation that we also find in the Latin scriptures is to say the supernatural bread. Give us this day our supernatural bread, which is the Eucharist. Even in the Our Father we pray for it. Now, but as John said, it is also, and as the priest prays, Lord God of all creation, I offer you this bread, work of our hands. It is our labor. We're giving back to God. Of course, it is His already, but it is also the fruit of our labor. And actually, we put bread and wine on the altar because all of us don't fit on the altar. That's why we put bread and wine there. Because this bread and wine represent us. In a symbol, we put ourselves on the altar by putting bread and wine on the altar. It is our gift. Ourselves, our lives, our joys, our problems, our sadness, our struggles, our work, our school, our relationships. We put everything on the altar by putting bread and wine on the altar. So that when bread and wine are transubstantiated, become the body and blood of Christ, we too get changed. It is supposed to change us. When bread and wine change, we too can change. If God, who is beyond everything, the omnipresent God and the Almighty God, can become and change a little piece of bread into His real presence, so much so that it can be eaten, or it can be trampled upon, it can be crushed, in the same way that at the mystery of the Incarnation, He became a baby that needed to be carried and fed, and that could be crucified and could be killed. In other words, the Almighty God made Himself tangible and vulnerable. And in the same mystery, every Eucharist, He again makes Himself tangible and vulnerable so that He can be received and eaten. He can be given reverence, or people could fail to give Him reverence or even disrespect Him. He makes Himself vulnerable so that we can receive Him. And that is the Eucharist. Now if God, the Almighty God, who is beyond everything, the only present God, can become small and tangible, can change a little piece of bread into His real presence, then how much more can He change your problems into victories? How much more can He change us sinners into saints when we offer ourselves on the altar in the bread and wine? And that is the mystery of the Eucharist. That the Eucharist should be transformative, should change our life. We should be changed people. We should have photos before and after. People going selling to Mass and happy hour. Going with a dark glow and then and having a saintly halo. We should be transformed. If Mass is not transforming us, there isn't a problem with Mass, but there is a problem with you. Then we are not open to what Mass wants to do in our lives. That is the mystery of Mass. So where in the Eucharist, then, I'm talking about concrete place during the liturgy of the Mass, where in the Mass
country.
So it is taken during offertory, two people, of God are bringing forward bread and wine, or they ask the service of the way. Bread and wine, if it's received by the priest, it's taken. Where is it blessed? Say, Lord, so that he can be given, share, be a set on a mission to go out. That's why so so where in the Eucharist then are we taken, blessed broken? Where in the Eucharist are we taken, blessed broken and shared? There could be several answers, and I'm just trying to figure out where do we see this happening even in the Eucharist, that we are called, that we are blessed, that we are broken and shared. Where are we taken? Where are we called?
Mass for this last word in Mass, Misa. Now they call the whole celebration Misa.
That's why in English and in Nico Pimans and the celebration is over. But mission is nothing. The whole celebration prepares us for our mission. So you shouldn't say mission is over, you should say mission is starting. Go, the mission is starting. That's why I love that. The other translation, the other options that the priest can use or that he can, I think the more beautiful. They go to proclaim the good news. And they all would say, go into love and serve the Lord. It is a goal, not for the sake of leaving the church, but go because of a mission. To put what we have learned in practice. So, the church calls the Eucharist the source and summit of our Christian life. We live for Mass and we live for Mass. It is the highlight of what our Christian living. It is the thing that gives us sustenance for our life, and it is the thing that we live towards. And so it has the two main words that we use for Eucharist is Mass or Eucharist. Now Mass means mission, and Eucharist is the Greek word that means thanksgiving. And so I think that beautifully summarizes this idea of source and summit. In seminary, we used to celebrate morning Mass, and I really enjoyed morning Mass because morning Mass is kind of, you start with Mass, it's the start of the day, it's what gets you going, it's what gets you up, and it becomes the bread for the day, the food that gives us life for the day, to live with the Lord. And so when I went to work in the parish, they didn't have morning Mass because the priest didn't like to work early, so we had evening Mass. And so at the beginning, I didn't like evening Mass because I was used to morning Mass. And then along the way, I started repeating evening Mass. Because one of the priests said, well, think of it this way. The whole day, you're still Mass is still to come. So you have to think that the best is yet to come. So I lived by the other way. I lived my whole day waiting for the Mass as the summit. As the source of the summit. So we must live. The Eucharist and life, they must go together. The same way as prayer and life should go together. I think that we should stop living life and praying prayers. Because very often this is the way we do things. We live our life and we pray our prayers. And I think that the Christian life should stop doing that. We should stop living life and stop praying prayers. And instead we should start living prayers and praying life. They have everything to do with each other. They are not two separate realities. I'm doing my life, I'm doing the way I live my life. My life is mine, I'm doing the way I do. And then all of a sudden I step out of my sinful life into this holy prayer and I say my rosary and I say these devotions and whatever prayers I want to say, or I go for Mass and I celebrate Mass. And then I step out of that holy place into my sinful life and begin to live the same way as I did before. And these two things are like kind of separate realities. And that doesn't make any sense. We should start to integrate them. That what I pray and how God speaks to me in my prayer is what should influence the way I live. And then what I live, I should bring to prayer. I should talk to God about what is really happening in my life and asking Him, and then He speaks to me, and then I start living it. Living my prayer and praying my life. And the same with Mass. That Mass, I should bring my life to Mass, and I should bring my Mass to life. Because Mass has sent me on a mission, and I start to pray, putting into practice in my life. And at some points I made the victories and I may do what Mass has told me, and then there were other moments that I failed to do it. And so I go back to Mass. And what are the first two things we do at Mass? We say sorry, I confess, and we sing the Gloria, we give thanks. We give thanks for the things that we managed to do by the grace of God, and we say sorry for the things that we didn't manage to do. And then we get inspired again by the Word of God, which instructs us how to live our life. And not just by the Word of God, but also by the Eucharist itself, in which Jesus gives His entire life. No greater love has a man than to lay down his life for his friends. That's the Eucharist. And so when at the end of Mass, the priest says, go, this is your mission, or the deacon now, he starts to say, go, this is your mission, we need to put that into practice. The Word of God and the Eucharist itself. To die. Not to physically die, but to lay down our lives. To die to ourselves and to give ourselves as a gift to others. great example I feel is my wife, because at 3 o'clock at night when my baby cries, she wakes from her sleep and she sacrifices her sleep and she loves her sleep, but she gets out and feeds up the baby. That is letting down our lives. When I wanted to watch TV, but I helped a friend because he needed something, he needed a listening ear, we needed to move house, and I sacrificed myself. Are we making a gift of our life? So, then we have Thanksgiving, and then we are sent on a mission. And this should be the flow of life. Thanksgiving and being sent off. So to conclude, the new Christian being a school, I think, of radicality and of transformation. The last book of the Bible in Revelation 2 says, I know about your activities, how you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were one or the other, but since you are neither hot nor cold, but lukewarm, I will spit you out of my mouth. If there is one thing that God really, really dislikes, it is people who are lukewarm. Lukewarm is good for nothing. Cold water you can use to cool things down, to ice to heal a bruise or something. Hot you can do to cook, or not lukewarm. It just looks warm, but it's not warm. It pretends to be. That's why it's called lukewarm. Now what kind of life are we? What is the Christian life that we are living? What are we doing from Monday to Saturday, after the priest on Sunday said, go, this is your mission, go and prevent good news? Are we living a life of radicality, transformation, or are we living a lukewarm life? The gospel challenges us. Come for me, lay down your life. And it is the Eucharist that is this challenge to us. It is the constant reminder to us of the challenge that God puts in our life, the call. You are mine. I have given my entire life for you. Now in return, you see, the only proper response to a God who gives his entire life for us is that we give our entire life. God is not interested in a Sunday morning, as in just our Sunday. God is interested in greatness. Am I living a lukewarm life? Or am I living a life of radical reform? That is the call. And Mass is the continual reminder of that call to be ready. To go all out for the gospel. I'm not radical in the sense of terrorism. Radical in the sense of radically living the gospel. And you know what is the good thing of the gospel is that if somebody really, really radically lives the gospel, he definitely becomes a better person. And he definitely is going to make the world a better place. That's why you don't need to be afraid of being a radical Christian, because a radical Christian will never be a terrorist. Because somebody that radically lives the gospel is the one that is going to lay down his life for his friends to give life. The Mass reminds us of that, and the Mass empowers us to do that because we receive Jesus himself, who is the bread of life, the food for our journey, to empower us for this mission. I hope and pray that the Mass inspires us and helps us to be transformed from glory to glory. That it may make us sinners to become one day God's sinners. Mass is the problem. So let's long for that. Let's be hungry for Jesus. So that the cross, the death and resurrection of Jesus, can transform us. Because that's what it's like. When you kneel, you sacrifice, and you can eat. History passes. We don't have time today for sharing. On the back, I put the gospel of the Emmaus walk. The two disciples, Easter has actually already happened, Jesus has already risen, but they don't know yet, they don't believe yet, and they are walking away from Jerusalem, they are walking away from community, they are walking away from their mission, they are leaving church. And the great thing is that Jesus walks with them, and he starts his conversation with them, and he doesn't condemn them, but he's there for them. then when we reach the home, he takes bread and breaks it, and he recognizes it in the break of the bread in the Eucharist. It is a passage that actually describes the entire flow of Mass, the opening rite, the liturgy of the word, the liturgy of the Eucharist, and then finally the sending on. They go back. They went away from community, they went away from their mission, now they return to their mission. They go back to Jerusalem, back to the others, and they share the Lord Jesus. My prayer for you is that in this time when you come in for Rekindled, we may also be connected with this Lord, and we may encounter him in a new way, so that maybe when we are walking away from Jerusalem, he's going to put us back on track. And put us back into community where we can encounter the risen Lord with our brothers and sisters in faith. So I invite you to just take this home somewhere in this week, and your own prayer time, you reflect on this gospel, maybe even more than once, it's quite a long gospel, and reflect on the questions below it, and say, hey, how does this inspire me from Mass, and what is God calling me to do in this season of Lent, in this season of Rekindled, to come back and to encounter him in a new way, especially in the Eucharist. So we can close the prayer, and then the Father and the Son will be his way. Father, we thank you for this evening, we thank you for the gift of your Son Jesus, who gave his life on the cross and arose from the dead to give us hope. And thank you, Jesus, for the gift of the Eucharist, which you handed down to your apostles and their successors so that every Sunday and every day we can celebrate the Eucharist and be present. That moment that once and for all you died for us on the cross and you rose from the dead. And that every Eucharist we can receive you, your real presence, and empowers us for our mission. Lord, we pray, Lord, that we may continue to be drawn deeper into the Eucharist, to understand it more, to discover its beauty, to be transformed by it, to be empowered for this life of radically following you. You make us treasure Christ our Lord.